It is recording.
It is, I can see it.
Hello, this is us answering your questions. Louis, who is Sherlock Holmes himself, although some of his later scenes were played by Benedict Cumberbatch, is going to be us asking our selected 10 questions from the internet. We have no means of editing this, so it's going to be kind of rubbish. Okay.
It's uncanny, isn't it, how much Benedict is starting to look like Louis, I think.
Yes,
well, it's very clearly. Yeah.
Okay, so Cumberbatch and Freeman aside, who portrayed your favourite Holmes and Watsons? That's out on the table there now.
That's good.
Okay, well, I think that's a question for Sue. So,
yeah. Well, I've always really thought Cumberbatch and Freeman are probably the best. For me, that's my choice.
So. Because they're the only ones you've ever seen?
Yeah.
Yes, okay. And actually watched all the way through. Yeah. All right.
That's the sort of ringing endorsement they'd like.
Well,
it's a fact.
I'm really off Dracula's now.
Yes, speak of Dracula's.
Yeah.
Well, it's a matter of record that our favourite versions are Basil Rathbone and Nigel Bruce in the 20th Century Fox and then Universal films of the 30s and 40s. But, of course, there are millions to choose from. We love Robert Stevens and Colin Blakely. Obviously, Jeremy Brett, Peter Cushing, Douglas Wilmer, who is in Sherlock. There's a lot to choose from, but we'd have to say, wouldn't we, Stephen, that those are our favourites, Basil and Nigel.
There's something utterly charming about Basil and Nigel. In fact, I think they're just, I mean, they're not, in particular, Nigel Bruce isn't exactly Doyle's Watson, to say the least, but, oh God, they're so funny and so good and so charming and the first people to really crack it. But yes, Jeremy Brett and Edward Hardwicke and of course David Burke, they were amazing. And Colin Blakely and Robert Stevens, I mean, that's the best Sherlock Holmes film. There's no question about that. And just because I'm feeling like it, I think John Neville and Donald Houston in A Study in Terror are always worth mentioning. They're really rather good.
Sue's nodding his
head. Yeah, well done, sir. Is that what you think?
Also, because we're in by the Basil and Nigel did it first. They modernised it first.
Yes. Well, they were the first people to deliberately modernise it, yeah. They
were. Or rather, their producers did, I suppose.
Yeah.
What's that?
No one's going to mention Will Ferrell in the new critically acclaimed Holmes film.
Do we want to be here all evening?
Yeah, that wasn't their fun. Not the finest hour of very talented people. But
right. Next question. What was the most challenging scene or scenes to shoot? Did the planning get more difficult the more popular the show became?
Ooh.
I would add on to that question that obviously the more popular it became, the more people you had standing on the street as you were doing it. And I know that you did some kind of fake, you faked some scenes to throw a bit of a spanner in the works.
We did. The falling down off the roof, yeah.
I remember all the scenes involving young Sherlock were particularly trying. We had a scene in my office. It just went on for hours.
Dog was quite easy, but you remember.
One of the hardest ones, weirdly, should seem like the simplest one, which was the one with you and Irene Adler, and it was in the study, wasn't it? It was a night shoot.
And Benedict, yes, it was the climax of Scandal in Belgravia. And Paul McGinn ended up restaging it three times. The fact that it was getting light, wasn't it? It was just impossible to stage.
It was weird because it's the one that we've done all the castings of. It was the more prep than anything else, and I think that was the problem with it, wasn't it? Also, you and I, do you remember when we were sitting down in the middle, in that hollow in Hounds, and we just thought, and I just kept glaring at you because you'd written it, and we were sitting down in the cold again at night.
Wait a minute, I just have to stare into the abyss for a moment. Also, we mustn't forget the Reichenbach Fall, that was a challenge, because that was about, in a feature film terms, the actual falls in The Abominable Bride, that would have taken about 4 weeks, and we did it in a day.
A day, yeah.
A tiny bit the next day of pickups, didn't we? But just the amount of water and what that does to a set. That was quite a challenge, wasn't it?
They were going to heat it up, do you remember? And then it sprung a leak. So it was cold water.
I don't know where it was, but I remember somebody somewhere, probably I think said to me in person, all that CGI, I nearly punched them. He built the bloody thing. It was there. There was a cliff. There was a waterfall. It was water. How dare you?
But actually, the crowds wasn't the problem at all because everyone was so well behaved, weren't they?
Well, yes, when they're
outside 221. Yeah.
Outside 221B would be ridiculous because there would be crash barriers up, and the other side of the world would just be solid with people standing and watching and in church-like silence. Ultimately,
brilliant.
I think awestruck by the mere presence of Benedict and Martin.
Yeah, we did start to limit what we wrote to be outside there, didn't we? Because it was just naturally harder and harder.
Mm. Yeah.
People burst into rounds of applause just because Martin opened a packet of crisps. Limit just.
He did open them beautifully.
Yeah. And when we were shooting for the beginning of series three, we faked up scenes with you and Moriarty, remember? To throw the crowd off the scent, scenes that never appeared anywhere. And we got so carried away, the director, Jeremy Lovering, had to sort of come over and say, would it be all right if we went back to making the actual show now?
I thought he was coming over to give us notes. So that
that's what you're talking
about. Not to worry about this.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, I don't know what this means. Why Euros and not Sherenford?
You don't know what it means?
Hey, man, I'm just the preface here, okay?
Why Euros and not Sharon?
Oh, Euros, it's only got one S. Yeah. So I thought it was Euros.
Yeah.
Is Euros with an S?
Well,
I've really nailed this train here. I'll just push that one over to you.
The idea of the third brother is obviously nothing to do with Conan Doyle. It was just speculation on the part of Conan Doyle fans, really, over the years. And there was this idea that the third brother might have been called Sherenford, which was Doyle's original name for Sherlock. And then we decided to bring in a sibling and sort of play with people's expectations by making it a sister. And the Greek god, I think, of the East Wind is Euros. And that's where all that came from. So the whole idea of the East Wind becoming something to frighten young Sherlock with and then actually turning out to be his insane sister. It's all a huge master plan that Stephen and I worked out about 1971.
Yeah.
On our very first train journey as children.
We hadn't even met. It just went that way.
But we were on the same train.
I thought it was talking about currency, so my bad there. Are there any Doyle stories that you wish you'd adapted for the show?
Is that my question again?
Yeah.
Red-headed League.
Well, Mark's always wanted to do the Red-headed League. I can't think why. While he's still got some red hair.
Yeah.
I mean, come on.
There's not much time.
Yes, I know. The Baldy League.
Before we reveal that Mycroft's a secret ginger.
It's something very tempting, but I think the speckled band is completely useless to us on Sherlock somehow, but it's a brilliant story. But what do you do with it? You never work out what to do with that.
I do know that.
It's such fun.
Do you remember that series, David Peary series, Murder Rooms, about Doyle and Joseph Bell with Ian Richardson?
I don't think I saw much of it, actually.
Joseph Bell, the man who inspired Holmes. They made it. It's a clever idea. It's basically a series of mysteries, and at least a few of them had the germ of what Doyle would kind of make into Holmes. And I think it's the pilot. It's essentially the speckled band, but it's about poison gas going through a grating.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And I suppose that's the sort of thing we'd do with it now, isn't it? It's not an actual serpent.
Yeah.
Because that's all very, very far-fetched. But if there was some means of killing someone by means of a connection between rooms or something. Yeah.
And it sounds like a snake because of the hissing, maybe.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah. It's all come together now.
Yeah, let's do it.
Yeah.
But we did, I mean, there's lots and lots, aren't there, still? I mean, lots of amazing stories or bits of stories that were very appealing.
So many ideas in there that we probably remain quiet on the ones we're really interested in. There's something quite, there's a genre of Sherlock Holmes story that starts brilliantly And obviously someone comes to the door and suggests to Sir Arthur that maybe a game of cricket is in the offing. And he just dashes an ending that rather quickly. I think five orange pips and the engineer's thumb will fall foul of that. Yeah. But they've got great beginnings. So sometimes it'd be interesting to extract those ideas and maybe... the Jeremy Brett series did a brilliant job on The Greek Interpreter, which is one of those stories that starts fantastically and sort of disappears, sort of stops. And they added a better, more exciting ending to it. And it's a really...
They did the same with the Pirate School. They have a big climax in the caves, which is really good. It sort of gives it a scale which the story just doesn't have.
Yeah. So I mean, all those things are out there to be played with, I think. That's good. All right, young Sherlock.
How do you think Sherlock will react to the whole quarantine thing?
I think Sherlock could quarantine himself for 3 months without knowing that he had. I mean, I think he could just sit
there. Yeah, he just solve things from home, wouldn't he?
I think he would be doing a lot of Zoom calls and solving crimes over the... I think it would be his challenge. Can I not leave the flat? And he does say, I think in the Scandal in Belgravia, that it has to be better than 7 out of 10 mystery for him to leave the flat. So I think he might relish.
It wouldn't stop him getting like Mrs. Hudson to go and get him food, though.
No, he'd think that'd be fine.
He wouldn't notice that.
Yeah, and then make Mrs. Hudson wear a mask.
Yeah.
As she delivers the food to him in case she's poisoned. And he'd probably sort of spray her down, saying, now go and get me some chips.
What is Irene Adler doing now?
Well, that's a good question. We actually know what she's doing. Weirdly, she's running a little boutique in Weston-super-Mare. She thought, all this international espionage, Mata Hari stuff, it's not for me, it's quite dangerous. I'm going to open the little shop. And she sunk all her bloody savings in it just as lockdown hit, so...
Yeah, no,
I thought it was a florist that she said.
Was it?
Yeah, I think it was
a florist. Maybe it was a florist. Yeah, no, it has a big tea. I don't know. Who knows what she's up to? She's doing something naughty somewhere.
Yeah. I like to think that and occasionally she gets into apocalyptic trouble and just texts Sherlock and he obediently shows up, sorts it out and goes away again. And that's what's been going on behind the scenes for years.
She's probably been trying to change the ringtone on her phone and it's never succeeded.
He's put it on buzz like everybody else, Irene. Yeah. What are you doing?
She loves it.
Yeah.
Which script changed the most from the idea to the actual final draft?
Oh, I think it was The Great Game, wasn't it?
Probably. Because
you had lots of, wasn't it? I think when you started to put them all into one.
No, that was always going to be that way. We added the bomb plot, which was Louis' first non-appearance in Sherlock when he was the kid about to be blown up.
That's right.
I think stayed the same, but we kept trying to ramp up the Jeopardy a bit. Because we were worried that the plot sort of started and stopped.
So you just went to killing a child?
Yeah, we just thought, well, let's blow up Louis. That'll be much more exciting.
That's a default setting.
Yeah, so that's obviously what you do. I remember, Mark, you attempted to do a version of Hound of the Baskervilles where Sherlock, like in the book, doesn't show up for the middle. And... we immediately were repelled by the idea and just and did the fix that everyone has longed to and just keep him in it.
I don't think there was one that I can't think of anything. I mean, the really odd one was The Sign of Three, wasn't it? It was a script that it was extremely long and it somehow wasn't long enough. We just kept adding incidents. I think it's a case with when you have mini cases, which are very exciting and fun to do. It's like doing the joke, just the tiny version. But then you forget that they don't actually take up much screen time. They seem to be full of incident. You go, I don't know why this episode is suddenly running short.
That is the oddity about it. Yeah, you're right. The Sign of Three was the most malleable just because however long we made it, However, because that script was about 140 pages long, which is insanely long, it still wasn't 90 minutes. Whatever we did to it, and we kept running past each other in corridors saying, I've got an idea for a Mrs. Hudson scene, and I've got an idea for this. And all those bits were added. And it's still not 90 minutes. It's not 90 minutes. I don't know how that's possible. So maybe that one. We did do a, remember Mark, we did when we were in the edit for The Six Thatchers, we changed the order of the telling quite radically.
Yeah.
The result of what became the pre-titles, and quite possibly my favourite pre-titles that we've done, with the best line into the titles as he walks off and all that, flicking his collar up. That wasn't the pre-title.
Well, it was big. We had this very elaborate thing, which we worked tirelessly on with Rachel, the director, which was the physical flashback, wasn't it? Yeah. And then it just didn't work. What we realised, I suppose, was, which is, it's a good idea. It just needs to be done for something like Agatha Christie's Five Little Pigs, where you're telling the same story from five different versions or something like that. But it was just, it was very, very ambitious and just didn't work, which is a scary moment for Sue.
I have a further question from that, for myself. When Sherlock, when he shows up on that boat at the beginning of the episode?
Boat.
Doesn't he have a boat sailing, like a fishing boat or something, and he jumps? He's on the roof of the fishing boat.
That's about a third of the way into the final problem, I think.
Then my question is completely irrelevant. And okay, move on real quick.
You don't have to watch them again, Leo.
Or even once. I mean,
he just watches his bit.
Yeah. All right. Sherlock, Watson, Moriarty. As woman, who are you casting?
For Sherlock, how about Michelle Gomez for Sherlock?
Phoebe Waller-Bridge would be rather good as Sherlock.
Who?
Phoebe Waller-Bridge would be rather good.
Yeah, she'd be a good Sherlock. Olivia Colman.
Judy Comer.
Yeah. Well, I think there's quite a few. I mean, I quite like the idea of Michelle Gomez. I think she'd be quite...
Or is she a Moriarty?
Yeah, but she's done Moriarty.
Let's not limit her.
But I mean, do you know, I was thinking about when I saw that question, I think it's a really great question. But I think we could sit here and generate quite a lot of names of female Sherlock Holmes. I think that part would go female very easily. I don't think you'd have to do anything. Yeah, change the pronouns and you'd have to change the name. Sherlock Holmes could be a woman quite easily. It's a surprise. Have they done that? Has Sherlock Holmes been done as a woman?
I think in China.
All right. Well, I haven't seen that. But I think that would work. But do you know what I get stuck on? Who is John Watson as a woman? I find that slightly harder to think of that kind of performance.
It just depends, doesn't it, entirely on the... It would just be a different direction. Different feel to it. Don't know. What about you, Louis? Who would you cast?
Myself was all three, and I just had to be quite, I'd have to make some different life decisions, but
I'll give you that much power. He's very hungry for work. Lockdown's been going on too long.
I'm taking a lot of hits today, all right?
So, come on, who's a female Watson? You've got to think of one female Watson.
Who's the person that played the main woman in Homeland?
Who is in Homeland? You watched that.
Claire Danes.
From Claire Danes, yeah.
You good?
Maybe I just find it hard to imagine any woman putting up with Sherlock Holmes. You sort of imagine a man would put up with Sherlock Holmes somehow, but a woman would just say, oh, fuck off. I'm just struggling with that.
You're very short series, but it already is.
I'm not sharing a flat with him, forget it. Or her, as it would be in that. I'm not having any inspirations for that. And all the same people we suggested for Sherlock Holmes could be Moriarty. So...
Okay, last question, sadly.
This is not the last question. We haven't done 10 yet.
Yes, I have.
Yes.
Oh, I missed one.
Oh, okay.
Go back to it. Second of all, guys, this is...
Come on, this is unedited. This is going
to... No, this is haunting me how this is unedited now. Everyone's going to think I never watched the show.
Correctly.
Or can count.
This is the one that doesn't have the TARDIS in it. You know, that's the main thing to remember.
Okay, all right. How would I Love You have affected Sherlock and Molly's relationship?
Oh, yes. I mean, that's the scene where he has to say it and to save her. That's interesting. I think I gave a very bad answer to that once because I was being interviewed on the phone and I was being irritated. But I think, I mean, obviously he would just have gone back and explained it to her once they'd left the island. He'd have said, look, I had to. I'm sorry if I hurt you, but that's what I had to do. She'd get it. The thing that changes in that scene, I really love that scene, is that Sherlock's huge emotional reaction to it afterwards is really a reaction to the fact he realizes that's the culmination of him having been an absolute arsehole to Molly for years and just realizing sort of in that moment, that was a terrible way to behave. So I sort of think he wouldn't ever be like that again. I think he would, I mean, he does love her, but not in the way she would like to be loved, but he does love her. He does, he would always look after her. He would always protect her if he had to. I mean, hell would fall on anyone that attacked Molly.
There's a way, isn't there, in which if he'd had the chance, he would have said, like Chris Tarrant saying, hi, I've got I've got to say I love you, but I don't mean it. I've just got to say it in order not for you to be blown up. Okay. But Euros was listening in, so that wasn't going to happen. And it would have been fine. He was, yes, I'll say it. Of course I'll say it.
Actually, last question now. I don't attack me this time. If you had, okay, this is really badly worded, so I'm going to have to paraphrase this. Essentially, if you had a massive, massive, unlimited budget when you were making the show, what kind of insane things would you guys come up with that you'd put in to the show that you couldn't because you were limited by a limited budget? Not that it was limited, but it was too limited to a certain degree. I'm trying to be very, very...
there's one tiny thing which we didn't do because of money, because I couldn't justify the cost, which was the elephant in the room. Do you remember that?
Oh, yes.
Because
It's better.
Yeah. But it's the most complicated thing because we couldn't get an elephant. You had to go to somewhere where the elephant was. You'd had to build the set around the elephant. And you had to build the set in time for the elephant to get used to the set and maybe knock it down again. And it went on and on and on, didn't it? And then we at the end said, should we just have the sound of the elephant?
Which is funnier.
We genuinely were going to go to Whipslade and build it.
And then we'd have found out in the cutting room that it was funnier if you didn't see the elephant. And we'd have cut the elephant, that's the truth.
But often money sort of holds you back in a good way, doesn't it, I think?
Yes, it does, definitely. And I think that's, you know, we've often talked about this in terms of, you know, I mean, you get amazing scale like that. I think the plane in Scandal is so, it really gives you something. It doesn't take off, it doesn't crash, there isn't a chase or anything like that. It's just got the whole show has a kind of filmic scale to it without it having to be massive stunts and those sorts of things, because it's not that kind of show. I think if we suddenly had millions and millions to do it, we might end up filming elaborate stunt sequences which we didn't use for precisely the reason that the best stuff is them sitting in Baker Street having a laugh.
We might have afforded the other side of that private plane then, might we? Remember that plane?
Oh, that, no, that's...
We had half off.
Yes, in... which way?
In Bride.
In Bride, yeah. Yeah, that's the smallest set in the world. It's just a backing.
Only half of it, so you had to shoot it.
And as Sherlock said in The Empty House, for a tall man, it's not easy for a tall man to take a foot off his height, which is what I had to do. That was genuinely more uncomfortable than any of the others, I think.
It
was,
and then when we had to shoot the other side of it, you just had to tip it the other side.
Yes. We could have built a bigger set with a sort of trap in it so I could stand lower. Yeah.
Well, that's the questions. I just want to put a real quick thing out there. No one attacked me in the comments about not knowing these things.
No one's going to.
They'll just be sending you little hearts, you know they will. They'll be, yeah, they'll be fluttering up the screen.
Yeah, that's how the internet works these days.
Yes, that's right.
Well, thank you guys for answering those questions, those 10 questions. Yeah. And,
I don't know. Happy anniversary.
Yes, happy anniversary, Sherlock.
10 years, Jesus. Where's that?
It seems fast, but at the same time, it does seem quite a long time ago. We had that extraordinary night when Benedict got stuck in Baker Street on his motorbike and we all watched A Study in Pink. And he was famous by the time he got to our house. an amazing experience.
Where is thank you, everybody. Thank you, all the fans out there.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you
for you know, showing more patience than any other fandom ever in history.
Stay tuned.
Goodbye. Goodbye.
What do I do now? Stop recording.
Yeah.